We've gone to open session. We are in open session. All my mobile phones must be set to airplane mode and on silent or turned off. It's not sufficient just to put the phones onto silent as it continues to interfere with assembly recording. The session has been recorded in video and audio and can be accessed live by online streaming either on the Assembly's website or Democracy Live. Members' apologies. I have no apologies at the minute. Chairman's business, members, just to advise, the report on managing legal aid was launched today. It did get some pickup on some of the media as well, so it has got out there. Agenda item 3 is the minutes of the meetings on the 7th and 15th of December. I just refer members to the draft minutes of the 7th and the 15th of December are pages of 7 to 11 of your packs. Are members content that I sign those minutes as being correct? Okay, members, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, members, matters arising out of those minutes? Nothing. Members, moving on then, correspondence, agenda item 5. Can I refer members to email correspondence received at pages 14 to 31 from Mr. Quinn? He has emailed the committee now a total of 28 times around a range of issues, including the RHI scheme, psychiatric services, high-tech investment and issues with the Northern Ireland Civil Service. Included in this correspondence was an FOI request, which has been passed to the governance services to action as appropriate. Just to advise members, Mr. Quinn copies a range of government bodies and politicians into the emails as well as sending them to us. So, members, could I just suggest that while acknowledging Mr. Quinn's praise of the PAC's inquiry into RHI and the suggestions on issues to consider on our forward work programme, which of course are welcome, many of Mr. Quinn's issues are beyond the remit of the Public Accounts Committee and most cases have been directed by Mr. Quinn to the relevant body, including heads of the head of service and departments and other bodies. Could I just seek members' agreement to note Mr. Quinn's correspondence and ask the clerk to record all future correspondence and to acknowledge his recent emails and any further correspondence on behalf of the committee, and just leave it to the clerk, who will deal with future correspondence on a case-by-case basis and, if necessary, bring it to the attention of members for further consideration where necessary. Members content?
Agreed.
Okay, members, agenda item 6 is the Northern Ireland Audit Office General Report for 2016. Can I refer members to the General Report from the Controller Auditor General, which is at pages 33 to 103 of your pack? I'll just ask the Controller Auditor General to get their place. Kieran, Louise, Kerry, you're very welcome. Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you all.
So, Kieran, over to you just for your summary of the General Report 2016.
I don't think you've met Louise on my right. Louise is in our office. She's in charge of financial audit, that's audit of all the accounts. And I suppose the big things on financial audit will come to the committee, but there's a lot of other work we do behind the scenes. Louise then give you an overview of just the key things. We published that in
early December.
Early December.
Yeah, I think you have in your pack the CNAG's General Report, which we publish every year, and then a summary document, and I was just going to take you through some of the salient issues in that, just to highlight them to you. I think it's important to say that all the departments contained their spending within the limits voted by the Assembly this year. In other words, there's no excess votes. Now, that compares to last year, when there's two excess votes last year and three the year before. So, I mean, I think it's important to highlight the good as well as sort of the bad. To move on then,
it'll not be heard anyhow. So.
There were four resource accounts qualified in the 15-16 year. That compares to 6 last year and 8 the year before. Two of the four qualifications you've already dealt with are dealing with, and I don't intend to spend any time on them. the main one being the RHI, which I know is on your agenda today, and legal aid. So I think you're all aware of those. The two other qualifications are long-standing qualifications. The first one being DSD, and it's the estimated level of fraud and error in benefits. And I thought it was just good to give you a feel of what the benefit there and the benefits is sort of expected, or what then estimate it to be. But I was going to put all the benefits together. So SSA administer something like 88% of benefits, the housing executive 11%, and land and property services 1%. And hopefully, as a financial auditor, I've got that to 100%. And the overall estimated level of error and fraud is 1.7% of the total spend. Now, this compares to the GB figure of 2.2%, so we're slightly under the GB figure. But I think what's very interesting is the trend. And I've pulled out some of the figures going back to about 2006. And from 2006 until the 15-16 accounts, the level of customer fraud has increased from 21 million per annum to 45 million per annum. The other types of errors and fraud errors we look at are customers' errors, and they have actually decreased, and official error has more or less stayed the same. So where we see the big difference is actually in the level of fraud or attempted estimated fraud.
So that's from 2006?
That's going back from 2006 to 2015-16. The other long-standing qualification is in the DARD resource account, and that's to do with EU disallowances, which in their very nature are irregular and automatically irregular. And the disallowances estimated in 15-16 were about 17 million, and that was sort of more or less on par with what was on the previous year's accounts as well. We have put a short report at the back of the general report on a very specific example that we looked at, and it was the control failures within the administration of the Rural Development Programme. Now, this isn't what the qualification is about, but it gives you a feel for the types of problems. It's a case study, really, and it gives you the types of problems we come up against. And what it was to do was with some grant that was being paid for quarry equipment. The grant was $50,000. Now, there are rules and breaches and rules and regulations that have to be applied when you're giving out the grant, and these weren't followed. So the controls were there, but the controls weren't followed. The amount was paid out before there was a site visit, and the site visits required, and it was paid out on the basis of a photograph of the machine. Now, the equipment was not on the applicant's site when the payment was made. It was not in the applicant's possession and in use until about a year after the grant was made. And then when we carried out a comparison of the photograph to the actual equipment, the inspection showed that there were significant differences. This was neither identified nor investigated by the department. It's something we picked up on our testing. And I think, you know, the department had no grounds which to recover the funds. Now, it's a small amount of funds, 50,000, relatively small amount, but I think the more important issue is these types of errors are what leads to the EU penalties.
So what department was that?
DARD, Agriculture.
How long has that gone on?
Well, this was our last year's audit. We picked up this one example. It's just one example.
So what year is that? Sorry to be clear.
15-16. But we have been qualifying in EU disallowances for quite a number of years, and we were just giving you a specific example of the type of thing we would find. It's a sort of a case study. Mm-hmm. That's just a case study.
How much have we, through the chair, how much have we in EU disallowances or whatever, how much have we been...
Well, I have, they've estimated for 1 year it was 17 million. I have figures here. 12-13, they'd estimated 12 million. 13-14, 10. And then the last 2 years, about 17 million each year. So, now, those are estimates. We have to work through the year. It takes a number of years to work.
Yeah, I think it takes about 3 or 4 years. Yes, before
yeah, yeah. But it's interesting, you know.
57 million.
It's quite a significant amount in terms of EU. Is there any other? Are we paying any other penalties to the EU over any? Maybe that's just a wide question, but I'm just wondering.
There's nothing that's a significant.
Nothing anywhere near on that scale. There's always the risk in other areas of infraction, but I don't think there's anything like.
There's nothing
the
in
moment.
That. Yeah. And I mean, I know if you take SEUPB, they're always being inspected and checked, you know. But I'm not aware of any other penalties or.
worth saying, we, the department has, even though the figure's still big, they have got better compared to where they were at one stage. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there's a lot more work we've been doing on an EU audit, through the National Audit Office. We do a lot of field work and tests for the EU, and where we identify that, we're just trying to help the department to avoid these penalties. So there's positive work done there too.
Can I take you back, Louise? I'm still been studying that figure from 2006, the benefit fraud, sorry.
Uh-huh.
You said it was 21 million per year, going up to about 40 million.
21 up to 45. Uh-huh.
What is that since 2006 in terms of benefit fraud, the total of that?
Well, so I don't know the total. It was 0.54% in 2006, so if you did it in percentages, and last year it was 0.78% in overall benefits.
But it's at least £20 million a year, going up to £45 million a year since 2006.
Uh-huh.
That's in benefit fraud.
That's in benefits. Right across the piece, not just SSA, that's them all added together. There are two other... If you're okay for me to go on,
yep.
There are two other reports included in the general report on that are actually referred to older accounts. There are 14-15 audits to do with land property services, the rates account, and the court's trust statement, which is due fines and warrants. The CNAG has, since the publication of this, has actually certified both the more recent accounts. So I was just going to give you mainly on the fines and the penalties, the court service one, just a bit of an update, because this is an area where you've looked at yourselves and we've sort of keep following up the issues. The department has taken steps to improve and address the issues raised by PAC, including new governance arrangements and control structures for fines. The targets have been set to monitor the execution of warrants and reconcile that to the number of warrants issued by PSNI, so there is reconciliation is now taking place. And currently PSNI are working towards the introduction of a cashless payment system, which should remove then the risks around the cash and the cash disappearing. But one of the issues in that is over half of the outstanding debt, so it's almost 11 million out of 20 million, is unlikely to be recovered. But they do expect the cash, the collection rates to improve with the introduction of the
civilianisation.
Thank you, because I stuck on that this morning. The civilianisation of the Enforcement and Collection Service, which is supposed to be starting from March this year.
That mean privatisation?
I was stuck in on civilianisation before I came in on that word, and I didn't change it to privatisation, which would have been the easier word to say.
I didn't remember.
So I just thought it was worth updating you on what was happening there. There are three other short reports at the back, which I'll just touch on very quickly, if you don't mind. One's a good news story. Another good news story, we don't always bring bad news, and it's on the retention of students in the higher education institutions. In 2008 and 2009, Northern Ireland had the highest level of non-continuation after first year in the higher education institutions. They have turned that around, and in 2013-14, we were the joint highest average student retention rate. We had the joint highest average student retention rate in UK. So that's quite a positive thing, where they've actually turned around the retention rates.
Like Karen, is that the colleges and universities?
That's universities. I was planning to actually do a fuller investigation then, when we saw the figures improving, I decided just to do a much shorter report.
It is only universities?
News. Yeah, it's just universities.
Right.
We haven't actually looked at the college retention rates.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And in relation to those retention rates, can you just explain that? Just what exactly that means. It means them remaining here and...
Not dropping out. The number of people dropping out of universities.
Yes.
Has decreased.
Yes.
As a partway through the course. So
do we actually take those figures right on through to see where exactly those young people or whoever they are, what contribution that has made to society or is there anything?
Very interesting. We haven't taken it that far. Very interesting just to do a longer term.
Yes, this was a shorter, sort of just a very specific.
Because why we looked at it was back a few years ago, there was a real problem with both our universities on retention rates, a lot of dropouts. So they have rectified that compared to where it was.
And would it be the case through the chair that, well, I would assume the level of intake has maybe decreased in terms of university? You know, would that have any impact at it, or is the level of intake still?
Well, I think the way they're calculated, it'd be percentage.
I suppose people completing universities in the year 13, 14, 14, 15 would have started before there was a cut in university and college numbers. So. Mm-hmm. Okay, Louise. Yeah.
Okay, and the Corian to Londonderry Rail upgrade. We've had a very short piece of work on that, really, to see what the situation is. Now, the plan was to upgrade the line in three phases at a total cost of $75 million. Phase one was delivered in 2013 on time and within budget. Phase two was originally estimated to cost $20 million. It was due to be completed there in December. Now, I haven't followed up to see what happened, but when we were doing the report, it was to be completed by the end of December 2016. At a cost more than a double the original estimate.
40 plus?
46.4 I have down here. Oh. And nearly a year later than planned. Now, I think you'll all be aware, because the ministerial directions come through here, there was a ministerial direction in this. But there were two competitions for phase two, and each produced a single bidder. And obviously the concern is, when there's a single bidder, there's a potential that you're paying a premium for the work. So it's just an update on the position on that one. So that's our latest on that. And the final one, if you bear with me, is protection of built heritage. Again, an issue which this committee has looked at back in 2012. And we obviously have been tracking the committee's recommendations. And while there's been some movement, the key concern of PAC was a progress to survey all the buildings and identify suitable buildings for listings. The survey was originally due to be completed by 2008, but then it was not expected to be finished until 2020, taking 25 years to complete. However, with the budget cuts, the contract has now been terminated at a cost of $80,000, and they'd spent about $500,000 on the contract. Now, about 65% of buildings that they intend to survey have been surveyed. But the department now has established a revised plan to try and survey the rest of the buildings, and the completion date has been pushed back to 2026.
How much has been spent to date, did you say, Louise?
There was $500,000 spent for work and then $80,000 to terminate the contract.
Okay. Trevor, you were looking at
that? It's just on the rail thing, the phase two. Does that then indicate that the other tenderers may have looked at the contract and decided they couldn't do it anywhere near the anticipated budget, so just didn't bother, and that's why you ended up with one bid, which you presume was allowed to expand and expand. That seems to be the way it's done. Yeah.
There are probably a number of other factors at work there, Mr. Lund. First of all, the local capacity in Northern Ireland, I suppose, because we have a very small network. What we picked up is around the same time there was a big modernisation programme in GB. Mm. So it's just there was a lot of work going on at that particular time. So that was that type of bidder's market.
Was the GB company who did the work?
As far as I know, yes. Yep.
Seems like fossil overspend, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Sounds a bit like the police college.
Okay, Gordon.
Was it a single tender action then in relation to it? Was it just the one?
No. It was a proper competition. A proper competition, yeah. We didn't find any fault with the competition.
There was only one firm came back, when the single bidder came back.
So how are they justifying the overspend then?
Well,
good question.
Well, there's other issues. There was, as Louise said, a direction around this as well in the day. I think it's be fair to say the then Infrastructure Committee look quite closely at this as well.
But was it the case there were unforeseen circumstances that the site wasn't properly
surveyed? There's other farm and there's other issues as well in terms of scoping and pricing work. Your predecessors and way back in time looked at the famous the Bangor line, and exactly the same. Mr. Lumpkin remember it. Again, there was a big escalation in cost, I suppose there's farm and sort of track record there at not scoping work, fully costing it. We find the same sort of thing in the culture and arts arena a few years ago, where it's really important then to get the scoping and costing right at the outset. So that's been a long run problem in this area of government business.
And I mean, it came out twice, and the first time, I mean, TransLink have acknowledged that there is a specification, was a too high a level. So had I carried further costing works before they went back out again.
But the old question is, what has been put in place to stop recurrence of this within this department or other departments? And has anything actually been put in place, in relation to processes and procedures that will give assurance that this will not recur?
Well, the Minister has put in place a project assessment review.
For this project?
This project. The Cabinet Office, to try and make sure they learn from it. Sorry, it was completed and issued to the Minister. It was completed in 2014. I'm just reading from our report here. So they have done a review on it.
But are there major issues there? Initially, was the job not properly measured and assessed and surveyed?
I think there's an issue around that, and hopefully, questions have lessons been learned. You could argue that the lessons should have been learned from the Bangor line way back in the day.
That's a long time ago.
So we have to keep pressing on with this. I suppose it would be an option for the committee to write. On that particular point.
Right, but surely that's what your role is about, is
yes.
Identifying the risks,
yes.
And from that, yes. Establish where you can stop recurrence.
Yep.
You know, you need to deal with these issues and introduce change that stops recurrence. Because some of us are not long here, but I think we're astounded with how much recurrence there's been. And it is probably one of the risks of government departments that, for various reasons, change is not implemented. Yeah. And as a result, recurrence does happen.
Okay. Just taking a rounded view of government capital projects and overrun. Generally, if we look over the whole system, some parts of government are very good at keeping within budget. Fair to say the education sector these days quite good. Major transport projects have always, roads projects are okay, but it's the railway stuff is, there's been farm there for a long time. And we also have problems on the culture and arts side as well. But taking a rounded view across government, there's some parts of government very good at keeping within cost, but it's important then, as you say, the lessons are
learned.
Spread across wider. And I suppose some areas are more difficult to get costings right, and unforeseen things come up. But,
this is a replacement track too. It's not as if it was a brand new.
Absolutely.
Route that you're constructing.
Yeah.
But you would think the risk is less.
And I think it was things like signalling and stuff like that where the figures were particularly out.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Chair.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, still on the same topic. Let me just get my head around this. Did the department experts estimate that this phase two should have cost in the region of £20 million? That's it.
Mm-hmm.
So it came in at £46.4 million. was only one company tendered. What was their tender price?
I don't have that figure.
Yeah, have that in there. We can. I don't have it on the top of my head either.
No, that's okay. If we're, any of us are still here, it'd be interesting to find out.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But I really do wonder, is it anywhere near 20 million or is it somewhere near 46 million? I mean, how much was the overrun? It's hard to believe that, as Gordon says, that this is a replacement job, it's not brand new. There may have been a bit of strengthening and so on required. I think that was the point, actually. But for a contract to go from 20 to 46 is outrageous. Now, I mentioned the police college there. That was in terms of the same sort of thing, because I know nothing's happened up there, but the original tenders for the police college, I think there were 7 companies tendered, not one of them could get anywhere near the estimated cost that the so-called experts had come up with. And I think, if I remember right, the Bangor line thing was along the same lines of a difficulty, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But who's doing the estimation to start with? That's where it seems to go wrong.
And sometimes it's not the organisation, as you mentioned, it's consultant engineers.
That's
well, I mean, the overall project cost came in at 46.4 million. And it said, and this did go to the accounting officer for direction, but it said they got independent assured that estimate of 40 million would be value for money. So obviously there's changes from the original estimate to 20 and then up to 40, and yes, that was why the direction then was given.
So some firm of consultants with the assistance of quantity surveyors and all kinds of experts came up with a figure of 20, which actually the true figure was double that. But, and I imagine then that the tender was probably somewhere around 40 million, which overran by another 15%.
Yeah. That's so
it's bad stuff.
Really, there's a price premium in there. I suppose the only alternative then, and that's what the direction was coming, not to go ahead at all and to reject the one and only tender.
Okay, Trevor.
Put it out for retail.
Just following on from that, I suppose. We had an inquiry around the previous experience, but remind me if I'm wrong, was it not the case that, and I mean, I agree with what Trevor's saying in terms of, on one hand, you have got so-called experts. Was some of that not even internal stuff the last time? And was the other part of the problem that there was part of the scheme was left off? So there actually had to be another part added on after it went out? There's something in my head.
From memory, I think you're right.
Yes. So we're not really, the danger with how, and I'm not criticising Louise here, the danger we have, short of actually having an inquiry on it, which we're not going to have time to do because we'll be finished next week, the danger here is that we're putting out something that, on one hand, experts said it was 20 million, but it came in at 46. But what we don't know is really what the other 26 was made up of. It could have been additions that was added that wasn't considered in the first phase.
To be fair, we haven't done a detailed piece in this. This was
just a short quick,
yeah, I understand that.
Getting the headline.
But I mean, the reality is they had experts, but it was internally, externally, started off saying it was 20 million, and they ended up at 46.
And Louise, we've seen this in local government as well. I mean, and I've been through it. I mean, I was astounded through local government seeing some of the so-called experts there saying what things were, and when consultants come in, it was always more. But the danger, I mean, and I'm not criticising you because it's good to get a report it, but we're not actually getting, I mean, because of the way this has been done, we're not going to see actually what the cause of the problem was. Whereas the benefit fraud's straightforward. You can see that you've went from 21 million a year in benefit fraud to 45 million a year in benefit fraud, and it's black and white. Mm-hmm. The money has been fraudulently taken from Social Security. I mean, it's there. This one here, because it's a contract, we don't actually know, has something changed midstream? The other one was theft. Now, people are getting exercised about £20 million in theft for RHI, but the same people that get exercised about that who held that ministry have said nothing relating to £20 million per year. Well, if you can count, Daniel, stay with me. 20 million times 20 is 400.
Don't worry, we're well
aware. Your minister was in charge at £21 million per year from 2006. I said nothing and stayed silent.
You've torn down these institutions.
Come on, enough. Daniel, you don't need that in here. The two of you know better than that. The two of you know better than me.
I'm pointing out the obvious.
I know you're pointing out the obvious, but you're making the political point here. Seriously, can we stick to the controller order?
It's funny, Carly, yeah. The whole institution.
Right,
it's funny, yes. Your minister was in charge since 2006 and blew 21 million.
You're the first minister and the whole place is falling to pieces because of your incompetence.
Sorry, there is no first minister.
Listen, the two of you are Trevor, Daniel, I've done it before on you. I'll do it again. Enough.
I'll make the point.
No, I know you've made the point.
I'm entitled to speak in this committee. His minister presided over £21 million a year. The pontificate in terms of the RHI.
Increased 21 million in 10 years, which is 2 million per year.
Yes.
No, 21 million pound per year.
Sorry, go back. Louise, 21 million pound of fraud
in the first year
in 2006.
In 2006.
Increased to 45 million.
It increased to, 45 million euros.
Yes, in 2016.
Per year?
Per year. No, yes, that's the amount was in that year.
In that year.
2006. What was in 2007?
Can we go through the years?
Can I make one qualification before we get it? This is an estimate rather than accurate.
And so is the RHI, Kieran. So is the RHI.
Facts are clear enough.
Facts is not clear. You have your own facts and you come to predetermine.
Facts are clear.
I think you have a cheek even to speak on it, given that you took a vote on it already.
Well, we'll see the electorate.
Looking forward to the election. Looking forward to it.
Look, and you can have your debate in the political sphere out here. That's when in time we're taking a report from the Controller Auditor General on a number of issues. Louise, I take it you've still another couple of
through. No, that's me finished.
Are you sure? There's one more in there. It's not on financial, but it's the confidentiality agreements for key public sectors. Kieran, do you want to touch on that, or is that...?
This is one where we're keen to get some good practice out there. Because from time to time, there may be settlements agreed in confidence. There's both on personnel type things and certain types of contracts. So we want to get out some sensible, good practice that almost a public interest list. And what we don't want is any public body hiding behind confidentiality just because a certain figure is embarrassing. There would have to be a genuine case for that. The Department of Finance has been working on some fresh guidance on this. So we just wanted to highlight that point in general. And I suppose if we come across anything in particular that we think needs to be publicly exposed, we will do that.
Okay, Robbie.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah. Just to take you back on to a different piece of ground, which was the DARD stuff and the disallowances, just for some clarity and around that, in my understanding that the fine of 17.4 million, disallowances, that figure relates to a departmental fine which isn't passed down to individual farmers and businesses. That's one that they carry.
Yes.
However, that money would be money that would be used by the department to support those businesses, farmers, at whatever level they choose. And it seems to be an annual rolling...
Yeah.
The figure's very close to what it was the year before.
It is an estimate, and it takes a number of years to get to what that actual is. That's the problem it'll take with the...
There is a timeline, but also worth mentioning the way the EU works, these are flat rate disallowances.
Yes, it's a percentage.
So it's rough and ready in the sense that if you have a lot of error, it's 5%. If you have less error, it's 2%. But that's exactly why the case Louise talked about, that one about the missing
the quarry
equipment, is so important.
Yes.
You wouldn't need too many of those. Say if you had half a dozen of them runs, the EU then would take the view then the error rate's too high, we're up in the flat rate. And the other point, you might think that 50,000 wasn't big. What really, really worried me about that wasn't so much the error itself, but the attitude to it and the culture in the department, that they didn't go after it and deal with it, even though they knew about it.
That's my point, Kieran.
Yeah.
Because it's not down to the individual, perhaps, being disingenuous. This fine is because the department failed to have the robust systems of measurement.
It's their own controls.
It's their own controls, sir.
Yes.
And I was worrying about that one. Yeah. In many respects, the controls are good, and the controls are working. The real significance of this is when they find a control weakness, it's important they act on it. And that's why I decided I needed to report on that particular case.
Sorry, and just the reason I'm saying that is because that, for me, that's £17 million, which could have been used for the mental health and around farmers and at the minute the uncertainty and the pressure that they're under.
No, I suppose being reasonable, it's probably too big a order to get that right down to zero. There have been disallowances right across the UK. It's not just in Northern Ireland. Yeah.
So just to clarify, that disallowance comes to farmers. It's farmers that lost out. It's not the department and so on that lost out. As an individual farmer, will lose 3% of his follow-in payment for the
following.
To pay that fine. It's a fine that comes from the farmer, not from the department. As the recipient, the overall department doesn't bear the brunt of it out of their central budget. That is what actually comes from Europe.
It depends on the circuit, because it could work both ways, but there's certain elements of it. I think the department is going to have to carry the can.
It comes out in the long run, the farmer loses the money.
It comes out in the round.
In the long run.
Which costs the farmer.
Chair, just on that, that's the Rural Development Programme, which is managed by Dard, or was Dard.
Yes.
Yep. So they're responsible. It is EU funding, or partially EU funding, quite a lot of it is.
Yes.
So those lag groups, that a number of them were on over the years, there was quite a stringent audit process in place.
Yes.
And I know a number of the councils had issues with them, you know. Mm-hmm. And so, from your evidence then, where was the non-compliance and how was it found? How was it found? Was it an audit done on site by DARD or was it done by EU auditors or on behalf of the EU funding? Are you aware of who you actually found the non-compliance?
Well, sir, in this specific case,
We
found it really in part of our EU audit.
You did?
We did, in this specific case.
Is this that you're doing on behalf of the EU funding, funders?
Yeah, we do to expenditure. We audit the departmental resource account, but we also do a major piece of work along with the other audit agencies to give assurance on EU funds. So that's a big piece
on behalf of the European Commission?
So we're effectively subcontractors to the National Audit Office
for this programme.
And we obviously, rather than test the thing twice, we make sure the work feeds into each other. You know, so if the test we do in one helps get us assurance for the other.
So,
but this specific case was one we identified.
Yeah, and this recently?
That was in our last round, which would be a calendar year.
Yeah,
wouldn't it?
Last year.
16.
I think it was 15 or 16's audit? I'm not sure it was 15 or 16's audit.
Go back to the old point. What has been put in place as corrective action to stop recurrence of this? Or is that yet to be implemented?
No, the controls were all here. They just hadn't been adhered to.
But we would have had I don't know if in front of me, Louise, the recommendation around those points. Then the department was...
But the processes and procedures are correct, and if they're followed, the risk would be greatly reduced.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So have we got an assurance that that is the case, or are we still looking for it?
Well, we will have got it through our report with the department, but then we will be following up to make sure it happens. And in the next testing round, we will be looking for the same sort of thing to make sure there's improvements made.
Well, maybe put it another way. The most recent report we're putting through to the National Audit Office here, but that's relatively, I understand it's relatively clean. Recent one.
I mean, I think to be it has been improving. It has been an improving picture.
I suppose what I'm trying to say is that even if we find a small number of things and breaches and all under EU rules, there is that risk of disallowance. So it has to be pretty tight.
But at least the issue was raised.
Yes.
They hadn't followed it through.
Yes.
Taken effective action.
Yes, that's it.
Okay, thanks, Chair.
Okay, hang on. Okay, folks. Okay, Karen Louise.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Members, agenda item 7, leaving an inquiry into non-domestic renewal heating centre. If I want to just bring members' attention to correspondence, received correspondence in your main pack 105 to 108 is from a member of the general public, which he states that it is vital to examine who is benefiting from the 20-year supply contract for wood pellets and whether monopoly supply has been established. He has provided the website link for a company which advises customers on the income benefits that can be achieved. Members, this was received prior to our Christmas recess, so I think it is and has been in general circulation since. Members, content to note that correspondence. Also refer members to a copy of Twitter message that I received at pages 5 to 7 of our electronic cable packs, which refers to missed opportunities, and it's just in relation to our inquiry as well, but I forward it on so the committee's aware that I've received Twitter correspondence. And also, can I refer members to email correspondence to the chairperson and a number of members of the general public at pages 8 of electronic tables or a number of suggestions that an individual has made in light of where we should be looking in regards to the RHI inquiry. Members content to note as well.
Okay. That's great. Is that the Owen McMullen one?
No, it was not. It's coming next, Trevor.
Sorry.
Okay. Just refer members then to the issue that Trevor raised. Is at page 9 of the electronic table pack from a Mr. McMullen on behalf of West Tyrone against wind turbines, who has requested that there should be a full public inquiry into RHI and an independent investigation into all sources of renewable regeneration. Can I just advise members that Mr. McMullen has also submitted an FOI request to the committee, which has been forwarded to the governance services for processing. Can I just seek members' agreement to write to Mr. McMullen and advise him that the PAC does not hold the information, however, his FOI has been forwarded to governance services within the Assembly for processing in the normal way. Members content to note the suggestion for a full public inquiry into RHI and to advise that the sole focus of the PAC inquiry is based on the Northern Ireland Audit Office report on RHI. Members content?
Mm-hmm. I'm content, Chair. Is there any circumstances in which the PAC would have to respond directly on its own behalf to FOI request?
It is generally, an FOI request is generally passed through to our governance services.
We have
to check to see whether we have the information. The reason being that that information could be held elsewhere in the Assembly, so it has to be a corporate approach to responding to
FOI. I'm struggling to think of circumstances in which, because the information we have is either in the public domain already, or else it's confidential.
There's no, the actual information that this is in relation to isn't actually anything we hold anyway.
Just in general, I mean, can't think that we would, can't think we ever have responded to an FOI request or ever would have to.
That's why it's been passed on to government services. Yeah. And the clerk is our registered data manager, is that the data holder in all cases of that. Okay, members, moving on then, in regard to your inquiry, we have received a number of confidential documents from the department in relation to RHI, so you can tell me to move into closed session to deal with those.
Great.
Members content.